Chapter 13, probability, exercise 13.4. Question number 1. State which of the following are not the probability distributions of the random variable. Give reasons for your answer. So they gave you a table like which contains 1, 2, 3, 4, 4 column and 2 rows. So x is 0, 1, 2 and p of x is 0.4, 0.4 and 0.2. So the first thing is we need to find the sum of the probability and we have to check whether the sum of the probability is equal to 0 or not. Sum of the probability is equal to 1 or not. If it is equal to 1, then you can call the random variable x as the probability distribution. If it is not equal to 1, then you have to say it is not a probability distribution of a random variable. Are you getting it?
Yeah.
You just have to find the summation of this. So now we're going to add this. So it's 0.4 plus 0.4 plus 0.2, which will give you 1. So 1 is equal to 1 only, we got 1. So we can say it is a probability distribution. We'll move to the next question. So next question. So again, like you just have to add all this. 0.1 plus 0.5 plus 0.2 minus 0.1 plus 0.3. So this and this can get cancelled out if you simplify. What? 0.5, 0.2 and 0.3. 0.7, 1.0. You're getting 1. So it is a probability distribution. All right. Just a second. Here I made a mistake. Here you have to check. Always the probability will be in the form of positive. That is also you have to check. In case if you see negative, then it is not a probability distribution. Okay? Because you are guessing about the probability of the event. Occurrence of event can't be in negative. Always it will be positive. It will be 1 or 0, or else it will be in the form of decimal or fraction. But always the probability will be in the form of positive. If you find negative values also, the random variable will not execute probability distribution. So you have to give reason like it contains negative value, so the probability distribution will not exist. Are you able to follow this? Did I confuse you?
No, I understand. Okay.
See here. But over here you are able to see negative values. This is allowed. The variable can be in the form of negative. That is not an issue. Only the probability should be in the form of positive. Okay, remember that. So now you have to check this. You have to add all this. It's 0.6 plus 0.1 plus 0.2, which is 0.9. So that is not equal to 1. So you have to say y is not a probability distribution. Understood?
Yeah.
And here also. If you add all this 0.3, 0.2, 0.4, 0.1, 0.05, you'll be getting 1.05, which is not equal to 1. So Z is not a probability distribution. And here if you see, you do have negative. You just ignore this. Whether the values of the variable in the form of positive or negative, don't worry, just ignore that part. We just have to focus over here only, at the probability only. Move to the next question. An urn contains 5 red and 2 black ball. Let me put it like this. 5 red, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 red ball and 2 black balls. So let x represent the number of black balls. What are the possible values of x? Is x a random variable? Two balls are randomly drawn. Two balls are randomly drawn in the sense they are not worrying about the color of the ball. This urn contains totally 7 balls. You are just picking 2 balls. Okay. So first thing is we need to write the sample space for the drawing of 2 balls. So it could be 2 red balls or 2 black balls. The first one could be black, the second one could be red, and in the last option, the first one could be red, the second one could be black. Are you getting it?
Yeah.
Okay. So when you pick 2 red balls, they are asking about the probability of the black ball, right? So if you are picking the red ball means there is no black ball present. When you pick 2 red balls, you are not picking the black balls. So the number of black balls will be 0. Now, so when you pick 2 black balls, it is 2 only. You just have to count it and write. And over here, when you picked black ball first and then you picked red ball, okay? So here you do have only 1 black ball. So the number of black balls will be 1. Last option. At first you picked red, at last you picked black. So number of black balls is 1. 1 red ball and 1 black ball. Here we are worrying only about the black ball, so you just have to specify it as 1. It is clear, right?
Yeah.
All right. So if you notice the number of black balls value, you are able to see 0, 1, 2. You have to write it as x is equal to 0, 1, 2. So those are the real value function whose domain is a sample space. Shall we move to the next question? You want to note it down?
Yeah.
Then?
Below the box.
You want me to show the box? Okay.
Yes, below the box.
Below the box, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So question number 3. Let x represent the difference between the number of heads and number of tails obtained when a coin is tossed 6 times. Okay. So tossing a coin 6 times, what is the probability of values of x? I'll give you a shortcut. Whenever you're finding the sample space for coin, you just put it as 2 power n. This n is nothing but the number of tosses. Here you're tossing the coin for 6 times, so you have to write it as 2 power 6. What is 2 power 6?
64.
Give me a second. You will be getting 64 outcomes. Just a second. Just a second. I'll just verify the sample spaces alone. Yeah, it is 64, but they didn't write all the 64 things. I'll just show you the sample space of tossing a 64 coins. I mean, tossing a coin for 6 times. It is difficult to write all the 64 options. Are you able to see here? I'll just put a box over. Sample space.
So in the exam, like, you should write this?
No, you don't have to. You don't have to. You just write it as like number of sample spaces 64. You just take a screenshot of it. You just go through once, you know? Like number of tossing a coin for 6 times means there is a probability that you might get a head in all the 6 times. And you might get tails in all the 6 times. Like first 5 times could be head, the last time could be tail, and then the tail can swap to the 5th position. So you will be interchanging its position. Like, you know, like how we do in flipping a like coin for 2 times, like HT, and you will switch its position and it will be TT. Remember, you apply the same logic, you will be getting 64 options. You just go through this when time permits you. Okay, just take a screenshot of it.
Yeah.
What they are asking, difference between the number of heads and number of tails obtained, which means you are subtracting the number of heads and number of tails. So they just asserted that into a table. So when you get 6 tails, like you saw that 64 option, right? Like this, like whenever you get like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 tails, there is no head present because you're tossing a coin for 6 times. So the number of heads will be 0. So the difference between 6 tails and head will be 6. Understood?
Yeah.
In case if you are getting 5 tails and 1 head, like this, like tail, 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 and in the 5th option also you are getting tail, and when you are tossing a 6th coin you are getting head, in that case number of tails are 5 and number of head is 1. So 5 minus 1 is 4. So when you're getting four tails and two heads, so four minus two. When you're getting three tails, three head, three minus three, two tails, four head, two, four minus two. You're getting it like that. It is. So one tail and five head, five minus one, zero tail and six head, six minus six. Here you are just counting the number of tails, okay? You are not worrying about its permutation. You are just counting it, so you won't be writing it for the 64 times. You will be writing only the six outcomes. Are you getting it? See, for example, five tails, one head, tail, 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 and head. This is also five tails, one head. And in case if I have tail at first and head at second, and assume like rest of the four options are tail, this is also five tails and one head option only, right? And you might be getting head in the first option, rest of the six, I mean rest of the five outcomes could be tails. Are you getting it? Are you able to follow? All these three information, yes, represent only one thing only. You are able to see five tails, 1 2 3 4 5, 1 2 3 4 5, and only one head. Because the question is about the difference between the number of heads and number of tails, so you just write about only these outcomes. So the value of x can be, just observe the values like these 6 4 2 0 2 4 6. So you're getting only four options, 0 2 4 6. So those values are the real valued functions. Please tell me if you don't understand, I'll explain again.
When it will be not real value function?
Sorry, when
it will, x will not be a real valued function.
Here you are getting a values like 0 2 4 6. These numbers are real number. In case you, if you are getting the values as imaginary, in case if you are getting the values as rational, then it won't be real. I'll explain with an example. You note down this and take a screenshot of that column.
Yeah, okay.
Give me a second. Just write what is real valued function. Real valued function is a function. Like assume f be real valued function. Whose domain is a subset of R. The R can be 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 100, 1000, 1 lakh, and so on. Are you getting it? So from that,
yeah,
you obtain your domain values as 0, 2, 4, 6. I hope I have cleared your doubt. We'll move on to the next question. Did you take a screenshot of this table?
Yeah, I wrote.
Answer. So 13.4. Find the probability distribution of the number of heads in two tosses of a coin. We are assuming the variable X is number of heads. Here the X is the random variable. So you're tossing your coins for twice. Number of heads. So when you toss a coin for twice, what you will be getting? HH, tail, tail, head and tail, tail and head. Right? I know you are familiar with this.
Yeah.
Calculating the number of outcomes. Tail, tail. In tail, tail, how come you have one? There is no... I think they are wrong. It should be zero. It should be zero. In tail, tail, you don't have any head. So obviously the number of outcome of the head should be zero. The probability also zero. 0 by 4, which is zero. Understood? Printing mistake. This should be zero.
Yeah.
Tail, head, head, tail. It should be 1. See, I'll put the table again. This table is wrong. I'll put it again. We just note down this. Let me write outcome first. That will be easy. Like you got head, head, tail, tail, head, tail, and tail, head. Okay. So here, X. No, not X. Let me put it as number of outcomes. Number of outcomes. There are two heads. Put two. You have no head, put zero. And here you have one head. And here also you have one head. So the probability is, so what is probability? Probability of the event is number of the event upon number of the sample spaces. You do have 4 sample spaces when you toss a, when you tosses 2 coin, okay, that will be 4. And number of event, here you do have 2. So if you simplify this, it will be 1 by 2. So that 1 by 2 will come here. 0 by anything is 0 only, just put it as 0. And here, number of event is 1, number of sample space is 4. And here number of event is 1 and number of sample space are 4. That's it. So if you notice the number of outcomes, you are able to observe the numbers 0, 1, 2. So those are the values of X. That's it.
Yeah.
Okay. Did they ask them, ask us to write the distribution table or what? Okay. So they asked you to find the probability distribution, not the value of X. So you have to put the table. This table is known as probability distribution table. So you have to write it like this. Like X and P of X. I will write that table also. So X, 0, 1, 2. So when you got 0 as the result, you got the probability as 0. And for 1, 1 by 4. And for 2, 1 by 2. Shall we move to the next question?
Yeah.
Find the probability distribution of the number of successes in two tosses of a die. Where a success is defined as the number greater than 4. Two tosses of a die. Two tosses of a die means?
Sample space.
No, one tosses of a die means like you will have six sample spaces. Two dice means you will have like this, like 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 3.
36.
1, 6, 36 will be having. But they're not worrying about that. They're asking the numbers. The number greater than 4. See, it could be, let me directly write those. It could be 4, 5. Yeah, because the 5 exceeds 4, and it could be 4, 6. Vice versa. 5, 4 or 6, 4. And you do have 5, 5, 5, 6, vice versa for this, 6, 5 and 6, 6. Understood?
Yeah.
Oh my god, I forgot to write these. Sorry, these. Like 1, 5. Here also you do have the value which is greater than 4, right? Here also. So this is the appropriate one. See, the highlighted one which is in the like light orange one. Like here the 5 exceeds 4. And here also it exceeds 4. Here also it exceeds 4. Here it exceeds 4. And this one over here. You have 5, 5 is greater than 4. Here you have 6, which is greater than 4. And these options, I have written these already. Okay. And these also. 5, 5, they are greater than 4. 5, 6, they are also greater than 4. 6, 5 greater than 4. 6, 6 greater than 4. They are classifying the sample spaces, the 36 sample spaces into 3 categories. Okay, those are both the number greater than 4, which is highlighted in the green color. 5, 5, both are greater than 4. 5, 6, both are greater than 4. Here 6, 5, 6, 6, both are greater than 4. You're getting it? So this part is both the number greater than 4 and one number greater than 4. One number greater than 4 means here the 1 is lesser than 0, lesser than 4, and 5 is greater than 4. So here only one number is greater than 4, and here also the 6, only one number is greater than 4, and here. Understood? So this thing is, and this thing here also 5, 1, 1 is obviously lesser than 4, the 5 is greater than 4. So the which they shaded in this orange, that one is one number greater than 4 probability. Are you able to follow?
Yeah.
And these, which is highlighted in the blue color, they are not greater than 4, which means no number is greater than 4. 1 and 3 obviously they are lesser than 4. 1 and 1 both are lesser than 4. 3 and 3 obviously lesser than 4. 4 and 4 they are equal to 4 but not greater than 4. So you have to discard this as well. So these which is highlighted in the blue is for no number greater than 4. Is it clear?
Yeah.
So we are assuming this. If you count the success, no number, which means the success is 0. So you are assuming the x as 0. Okay. And here, the success is you are obtaining only one number greater than 4. So the success is 1 for these 4 options. And for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. For these 8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. For these 16 options, you are obtaining x as 1. Understood? And for these 4 options, you are getting the both the number greater than 4. So just count them. So x is 0, which means miserably fail. Count it. 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 cross 4 is 16. So number of outcomes are 16. So the probability is number of event upon number of sample spaces. So that is 16 upon 36. If you simplify this, you'll be getting the result as 4 by 9. And here, 1. Count these oranges. 16. Again, 16 upon 36, which is 4 by 9. And here, which is highlighted in the green color. 4. 4 by 36, which is 1 by 9. That's it. Is it clear, dear?
Yeah.
Give me a second. Let's have some water. Excuse me. All right. Question number 6. From a lot of 30 bulbs, which include 6 defectives, a sample of 4 bulbs is drawn at random with a replacement. Find the probability distribution of the number of defective bulbs. So imagine you have a box. That box contains 30 bulbs, and you are not sure which one is good and which one is defective. But they stated that that box includes 6 defective bulbs. So what is the probability that we might draw a defective bulb?
We did only first subdivision of fifth sum.
Which one?
Fifth sum.
13.5.
Yeah.
Just a sec. Oh yeah. How many subdivisions are there? Okay, the second subdivision you take it as a homework.
Okay.
You just try. If you're not getting it, I'll help you.
Yeah.
Do you have binomial distribution for this exam?
Let me
tell you. You're not sure. Actually, it is there, I guess, because like the PDF you have shared, na, in that I have saw that probably, I mean, binomial distribution. Just a second. Where is it? Probability distribution. Actually, in the book or the PDF you shared, right, in that also they mentioned about the Bayes theorem. You just confirm with your school teacher whether you are getting Bayes theorem for the exam or not. Okay. stick with her anymore.
Actually, like the paper I sent you no yesterday worksheet.
Yeah.
In that, one of my friend asked, ma'am, like whether the Bayes theorem is there or not. The first question is also Bayes theorem. So, like, ma'am said, like we don't have Bayes theorem.
Okay.
So like from that.
But answer, now the PDF that you shared right through the link, the CBSE link, that contains binomial distribution.
Yeah, it's the binomial distribution variance. Poisson and normal distribution is not there. She didn't teach. Okay. We don't have that.
Fine.
Till binomial distribution.
Yeah, we'll discuss this. Okay.
Like so here, how many?
Yes.
How many sums we have for binomial distribution?
I'm not sure.
Like not full sure. Exercise is there for that?
I'll just see. I think maybe 3 to 5 questions.
Yeah. Only this much?
No. We do have like random questions as well. Like apart from the binomial distribution, we do have other topics as well in the same exercise.
And like we would be able to complete that numbers first chapter.
First chapter, I don't think so. Like today it is 5, na? Your exam is on 9.
Yeah.
I'm not sure. You try to revise it by your own. I'll try to send you some videos. If time permits, we'll see. I'll try my best. I think like it is not possible because I think we might be having like 2 to 3 sessions before August 9th. So we'll be discussing only this probability only, I guess. Because this contains miscellaneous also.
Like Sunday we'll be doing 1.5 hour.
Yeah, we'll do.
I'll try as like we'll I'll try, just go
we'll
through
try as much as possible. We'll try our best.
Saturday I have one more exam. Like Saturday night I can just see your videos again because like before that I won't be.
Alright. I'll send it by tomorrow itself.
Like I have the videos like YouTube I found once like we'll be teaching in Hindi.
Okay. So you're comfortable well. With that. Fine then.
Yeah.
Fine. If you have any doubts, you just post me in the WhatsApp, okay?
Yeah.
Okay.
Only this permutation and combination is creating problem for me.
You're facing the problem.
Yeah, I have to like solve some more problems in that.
Okay. You don't worry, if you solve more problems, you will get it. You just solve them and you ask me if you have doubt in that. Okay, yeah. Let's discuss the binomial distribution now. Give me a second, binomial distribution. Okay. Note down this collection of trials is called Bernoulli trials. To qualify a trial as a Bernoulli trials, we do have 4 conditions. So that trial should at least qualify 1 condition. Okay, I'll just write them. It should be finite. and it should be independent by nature. Finite means you will be able to count. I think you know what is independent already. That intersection should be equal to the multiplication of the individual events. Do you remember that? And if it is defined as success and failures, you will be having exactly two outcomes, not more than that. Each trial, like imagine you're just flipping a coin, you'll be getting tail or head, just two. Trial has exactly two outcomes. Defined as success and failure. This is third condition. The fourth condition is the probability of the success remains the same in each trial. I'll just write probability of success as P of S remains the same in each trial. In this question, they gave you a case about the bulb. Picking a bulb is a Bernoulli trial here. And they've also stated that 30 bulbs, it is finite. Okay, they mentioned the finite numbers. So it is Bernoulli trial. Understood?
Yeah.
And the binomial distribution. This is the form. P of x is equal to small x ncx q power n minus x power, times p power x. So p will be success and q will be failure. Okay, here they are assuming the probability of getting the defective bulb as p. And you know this already. P plus q gives you 1, right? So from that you can say Q is equal to 1 minus P. So if you find the value of P, you will be able to get the value of Q also by substituting in this. So let's find what is P first. Probability of getting the defective bulb. In the question itself, they said it includes 6 defective bulbs. Not less than 6, not greater than 6. It is finite value. It is 6. So number of event for getting the defective bulb is 6. So in the probability you will be writing n of e upon n of s. So what is the total sample? 30. So that will be in the denominator. If you simplify this, you will be getting the answer is 1/5. So that is p. And what is q? Subtract this p from 1, you will be getting 4/5. Understood? And they said a sample of 4 bulbs is drawn at random. See, this is important. You are drawing 4 bulbs, right? So that is going to be the n, number of times we pick a bulb. Understood you?
Yeah.
So now we are just going to substitute in the binomial distribution. And we know the value of n, we know the value of q, we know the value of p. What about x?
Can you show me the formula?
Yeah. We know the value of n, q, p. And what about x, Jixia?
S is 30.
X is?
You said
it's the number of defective bulbs, right? So you are picking four bulbs. So I have to start from zero. So you're picking one bulb from the urn. I mean from the box. Like imagine like this. I'm not drawing 30. Just okay. So first, you're picking one bulb. X is zero. Lucky you. You're not getting the defective one. It was a good one. Okay. So that is X equal to 0. Understood? X equal to 0 means the bulb is not defective. It is a good bulb. Okay. So you're just substituting the value of X as 0 in this. And the value of N is always 4. The value of Q is always 1 upon 5. The value of P is, I mean, P is 1 by 5 and the value of Q is 4 by 5. Okay. So you're just simplifying it. So it's 4C naught 1 by 5 whole power 0, 4 by 5 whole power 4 minus 0. I'll show you the simplification. See, 1 by 5 whole power 0. Anything power 0 gives you 1. Right? So this will turn into 1. So I'll write it here. It's 4C0 into 1 into 4 by 5 whole power 4. You can use calculator. We can save time. In the exam, you will be doing it manually, but now you just use calculator to just verify. You just verify only one. You don't have to calculate this thing and all. So you just check and tell me what you're getting for this thing.
What should we do for 4C?
Sorry,
I was asking about 4C0, like you said earlier.
Yeah, I will explain that. I'll explain. We will be using NCR formula in that. I'll explain that. You just tell me what you're getting for 4 by 5 the whole power 4.
It is 64
by
125. 125
or 625?
Okay.
So it's 4C0 times 64 upon 625. Okay, so now we'll expand this. I'll just keep that aside. 4C0. So it is in the form of NCR. And what is the formula for the NCR? It is N factorial upon R factorial times N minus R factorial. So when you write 4C0, you just compare this with this. The value of N is 4. The value of R is 0. Okay. So it's going to be N factorial is going to be 4 factorial. And R factorial is going to be 0 factorial. And N minus R factorial is nothing but 4 minus 0 factorial. So let me write it as 4 factorial divided by 0 factorial is nothing but 1. Remember. It is 1. And N minus R factorial. So it's 4 minus 0 factorial, which is 4 factorial. I think 4 power 4 is 256, not 64. 4 cube is 64, right? 4 fours are 16, 16 fours are 64. 64 times 4 will give you 256. See. What you can do, you can cancel out the 4 factorial and 4 factorial straight away. So, you'll be getting 1 only. So, these things will be interesting. I'll solve these. These NCR will be interesting. I'll solve these. Shall I erase it?
Yeah.
For 4C1. For 4C1, the value of N is 4 and the value of R is 1. So it's going to be 4C1 and N factorial divided by R factorial into N minus R factorial. 4 factorial upon 1 factorial times 3 factorial. I have subtracted 1 from the 4. So it's 4 factorial by 1 factorial into 3 factorial. I can write 1 factorial as 1. Okay. Just write 3 factorial as 3 itself. If you want, you can expand it for the simplification process. I can write 4 factorial as 4 into 3 factorial. Because what is n factorial? It is n into n minus 1 factorial. Okay. So now you can cancel out this 3 factorial and 3 factorial. You are left with the real number 4 by 1, which is 4. Understood?
Yeah.
You just see whether you have the same value in the denominator also. If you're having that, you don't have to expand after that. You just stop till there. Like I will explain this, you will get to know. For 4c2, it is 4 factorial upon 2 factorial times 4 minus 2 factorial, right? So that's going to be 4 factorial upon 2 factorial into 2 factorial. So it's 4 factorial upon 2 factorial can be written as 2 times 1. And this 2 factorial can be written as 2 times 1. You are not allowed to cancel out the factorial term with the real number. Okay. You have to expand this. So now I can rewrite the 4 factorial into 4 times 3 times 2 times 1. Understood? Now I can cancel out this 2 and this 2. I can cancel out this 4 and 2. I'll be having 2 in the numerator. So it's 2 times of 3 into 1 is 6. So that's 6. Understood?
Yes.
4C3, 4C4. Do this by yourself, like 4C3 and 4C4. Tell me whether you obtain the same result or not.
Yeah, I'm getting the same answer.
You're getting the same answer. So now it's time to draw the probability of distribution. So it's you have to draw it for 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 and just write the final results. 256 upon 625. 256 upon 625 for the P of X equal to 1 and 96 upon 625 for this. 16 upon 625 for this. 1 upon 625 for the 4. It is compulsory to draw the table at last. Shall we move to the next question, dear? Yeah, this is also quite easy. Okay. A coin is biased so that the head is 3 times as likely to occur as the tail. If the coin is tossed twice, find the probability distribution of number of tails. Before starting this question, I would like to ask, what do you mean by biased coin and unbiased coin?
Biased means the person is choosing only one person, not the other, ignoring one person.
Like unfair? Unfair, yeah. Unequal, can we say that? Okay, good. So the set head is three times as likely to occur as tail. It means that if four times coin is tossed, three times there will be head and one time there will be tail. Are you getting it?
Yeah.
You are tossing a coin for twice. They just define the actual event. When you toss a coin for twice, you will be getting head head, tail head, head tail, tail tail. Right? So you are getting head in this, and in this. You are getting head for the three times, right? And you are getting tail for the one time. Let's see. So P of H. 1, 2, 3. There are three heads out of four sample spaces. So P of H is equal to 3/4. And tail. And see, I have a question. Let's see, just give me a second. Sorry for that. Okay. So here also I'm having tail, tail, and here also I do have tail. Why I'm not including these two tails? Why I'm not including these two options in this? Why I'm assuming the n of e is 1? Because it is biased. You're supporting the head only. You're not supporting the tail here. They told you have to take head for three times and you have to take tail only for one time. Are you getting it?
Yeah.
All right. So probability of getting the outcomes as two heads, both the heads. So we know the value of both the heads, which is 3/4. So it's 3/4. You have to write it as, for both the heads, you have to write it as P of H, P of H. See, for the unbiased, what do? You usually calculate from this. From this, we'll calculate. Right? From this, we'll calculate, you will write it as 1/4. That is what we do in unbiased. When it comes to biased, you have to write it as head as probability of head multiplied by probability of head. You have to write it like this. Understood? And they've defined the probability of H as 3/4 that you are substituting here. So that's going to be 9/16. And probability of getting head, tail and tail head. So probability of getting head in the first and tail in the second. So you are splitting this head tail into probability of H times probability of tail. And you know the value of probability of head, which is given in the question, 3/4. And probability of t is also given in the question, which is 1/4. Just substitution and basic multiplication. So it's 3/16. And for this as well, you're getting 3/16. And you're adding these because you're calculating for the variable 1. For the random variable 1. That is why we are adding these two. And when it is 2, both are tails. Probability of tail times probability of tails, which is 1/4 times 1/4, that gives you 1/16. Understood?
Yeah.
Here they are assuming the excess number of tails. You have 0 tails. You have one tail, here you have two tail. So now we will be drawing the probability distribution table for this and this. Drawn it here. So when it is 0, it is 9 by 16. When it is 1, it is 6 by 16. When it is 2, it is 1 by 16.
The allow table is not enough. We should make another table also.
I'm not getting. Are we allowed to?
The about table is not enough. Already everything is mentioned over there. So again, we have to make a small probability distribution.
Yeah. It is compulsory to make that table. Whenever they ask for this probability distribution, they will use this table only. It is depending upon the teacher also. The teacher is cool, she'll give you marks for that table itself. If you don't find time, then you can stop up to that. If time permits you, if you are worrying about these step marks and all that, write that as well. You can expect this kind of question. This is just a second. Distribution. Yeah. So you do have a discrete random variable and continuous random variable, and you'll be doing the distribution of discrete random variables. So this comes under that topic, discrete probability distribution. Are they asked? Okay, just basic probability distribution. All right. A random variable x has the following probability distribution. They gave you the distribution, see, the table. They're asking us to determine the value of k. And I've told you in the very first problem itself, we will be adding all the probabilities and we will be checking whether the sum of the probabilities is equal to 1 or not. Okay. And if it is equal to 1, you will assume that as a probability distribution. If it is not equal to 1, we'll assume that as, oh my god, what happened? Just a second. Yeah. How did I close that? We were discussing question number 8, right? Okay. So here they were stated that it is a probability distribution, which means the sum of the probability should be 1. So you just have to add all these and equate it to 1. That's it. So if you add all this k plus 2k, 3k plus 2k, 5k plus 3k, 6k, and you do have one more, which is 7k. 9k. Okay, here you do have 3. 1k, 2k, 3k, 5k, and here you do have another 3k. It is 8k and it is 9k. Yes. So you're getting 9k and you'll be adding the k squares. It's k square plus 2k square plus 7k square will give you 10k square and equal to 1. So it's 10k square plus 9k minus 1 equal to 0. and we are going to factorize this in order to obtain the value of k. And you can use splitting the middle term method. You can rewrite 9k as 10k minus k, right? And you just take 10k as common from these two terms, and you will be left with k from this first term and 1 from this term. So if you are writing k plus 1, you have to write the k plus 1 here as well. But here you do have minus k and minus 1. So just take the minus as common, minus 1 as common, you will be getting k plus 1. So now you will be clubbing this 10k and minus 1. You will be taking, or else you will be taking this k plus 1 expression as common. So it will be 10k minus 1 and k plus 1. So if you are equating this to 0, it's going to be 10k minus 1 equal to 0. Say 10k is equal to 1 and k is equal to 1 by 10. So k plus 1 is equal to 0 and k equal to minus 1. And we know that already the probability distribution cannot be negative. So you are ignoring it. We have to choose this. The value of k is 1 by 10. Are you able to follow it? Are you there?
Yeah.
Are you able to follow the answer? Hello.
Yeah.
Are you able to follow the answer? Is my explanation was clear?
Yeah.
Okay. This is also pretty easy. The random variable x has the probability distribution p of x of the following form, where k is some number. So it is given as p of x equal to k when x is 0, and 2k when x is 1, and 3k when x is 2. And for the other option means, like if the value of x is 3 or 4 or 5 or something, then the probability is 0. They are asking us to determine the value of k. And with help of this, we can able to draw the distributive table. For 0, 1, 2. For 0, it is k. For 1, it is 2k. For 2, it is 3k. Just mention its corresponding value. You will be able to prepare the tabular format. And then, same thing. You just have to add all this and equate it to 1. So it's k plus 2k plus 3k equal to 1, which is 6k equal to 1. The value of k is 1 by 6. Is it clear? Hello, are you busy now?
No, ma'am.
Because I was asking whether you are able to understand the answer or not. I'm not receiving any response from your side.
Like my parents are moving here and this man was not able to split.
Sorry?
My parents are moving here and so I was not able to on my mic.
My parents are there. Fine. Okay, mark this question. Okay, this is mean and variance. This is discrete distribution. You can expect this kind of question, like mean and variance question for the exam. So this is the formula for the mean, note it down. So mu is equal to E of x, which is equal to summation I equal to 1 to n xi times pi. Just one step extra. You know how to draw the probability distribution, right? After that, you just have to multiply these and sum up. That's it for the mean. You'll be multiplying 0 and 1 by 8. So that will be 0. 1 and 3 by 8, that is 3 by 8. 2 and 3 by 8, which is 6 by 8. 3 times of 1 by 8, which is 3 by 8. You will be adding those results. So you will be getting 12 by 8 as the result. I will explain the distribution table anyway. Find the mean number of heads in 3 tosses of a fair coin. So when you toss a coin for thrice, what will be the sample space? I am asking in general. What is the sample space for tossing a 3 coin?
3 times.
Yeah, when you are tossing a coin for thrice, what will be the sample spaces? The number of sample spaces?
2 by 3, 8. Yeah.
Okay. Tail. Like this, you'll be getting. Understood? Like 8 options. It's okay. So here, so when you toss a coin thrice, they are worrying about the head only, the number of head. So it could be 0, it could be 1, it could be 2, or else it could be 3. So you do have 4 outcomes. Okay. So when the value of x is 0, all the 3 options will be tail. In the first tossing also you are getting tail, in the second tossing also you are getting tail, in the third tossing also you are getting tail. So the number of outcome is 1. So when you write the probability for this, you will be writing number of event upon number of sample spaces. So now total number of sample spaces is 8, so that's going to be 1 by 8. And 1 means number of heads should be 1. Here the number of head is 1, and here the number of head is 1, and here the number of head is 1. It is 3. It's 3 by 8. Understood?
Yeah.
So for the head, tail, head, you are having 2 heads, right? So the number of outcomes are 3. So it's going to be 3 by 8. And you are getting H, which is 1s. Like the 1 minute. So probability of getting the number of heads for the, I mean you are getting 3 heads, you'll be getting only 1 time. So that is going to be 1 upon 8. Just give me a second, I'll just check that. So now you will be writing these 2 columns as the probability distribution table. Okay. So this will be the probability distribution, and I've told you already for the mean you will be multiplying this x and p of x, and you'll be adding all those. So it's 0 plus 3 by 8 plus 6 by 8 plus 3 by 8 will give you 12 by 8, which is 3 by 2. So 3 by 2, if you simplify, you'll be getting 1.5. And it is not compulsory to simplify this. You can leave it as 3 by 2 itself. Is it clear?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Shall we stop here?
Yeah.
Okay then. Okay then. Let's see. Shall we have class tomorrow or what?
Yeah, we can. Timing?
Timing like the same time? Like 7?
7 to 8? Yeah.
Alright. Okay then, we'll wind up this session. Thank you.
Thank you.